It is time for Spirit Daily. I'm Zach Martin, along with Michael H. Brown, the author of his latest book, Lying Wonders, Strangest Things. And we'll get to some of the chapters in that book a little later on. Right now, I want to go directly to the site, spiritdaily.com, where you can find out what Michael is doing these days. And we have some stories that are in red, and I'm just going to pick a few, and maybe you can discuss what these stories are about. I'm not going to blindside you by anything, but I think if they're up on the site, you probably know a little bit of the background. The first thing that I see that I'm really interested in, Michael, is top Irish exorcist bring back St. Michael's prayer. What is St. Michael's prayer, and what does it have to do with exorcism?
Well, you know, that was the prayer that supposedly originated with, or was promoted, I should say, by Pope Leo XIII, who in the 1880s had some type of experience that had to do with the devil and the devil being given a period of time, a prolonged period of time, to test the church. And afterwards, he took a prayer that had been around for decades in the Catholic Church, a prayer invoking the Archangel Michael, and he kind of edited it and changed a few things and then ordered that it be said to at masses, at Catholic masses around the world, which it was from 1886 to the mid-1960s to actually till 1967. They took it away, and it's ironic because it was right after they took it away and did other things within the church that you had this monstrous abuse crisis begin to simmer, or at least germinate, I guess is a better term, because it was in the late 60s and 70s that you had this flood of seminarians who became, in my opinion, diabolically possessed to do what they did, thousands of them, to young people. So there is a movement now, including, like you say here, excuse me, of the top exorcist in Ireland, saying, put this prayer back. And I've written about it on Spirit Daily a number of times through the last 19 years. Our site was dedicated to the Archangel Michael 19 years ago, 3 days from now, 19 years ago this weekend, on his feast day on purpose. And I have argued a number of times on the pages of Spirit Daily to reinstitute this prayer: St. Michael, the Archangel, defend us of the battle, be our safeguard against the wickedness and snares of the devil. May God rebuke when we humbly pray, and do thou, O Prince of the heavenly host, by the power of God, cast into hell Satan and all the evil spirits who prowl about the world seeking the ruin of souls. Amen.
You can find that prayer in what we call the St. Ambrose Prayer Book, and it was produced by the Antiochian Orthodox Church for the Western Rite, which is part of the Russian Church abroad. It's a Western Rite, which is, I would say, pre-Vatican II Catholic in the way it looks in its practices. Mm-hmm. There's also the Missal of 1962, which the readings are more in line with many of the readings that you'll find in the Orthodox Church and its presentation. For instance, as an example in the Gospel, at that time, Jesus. And Jesus said the following parable, which starts the Gospel reading. So I think going back to the pre-Vatican II liturgies and looking at some of those prayers is really a good spiritual practice. You rediscover your ancient faith before Vatican II comes along. And then I've listened to this in the past, Michael, where Father Malachi Martin is on with Art Bell. And also I think I've heard even Archbishop Fulton Sheen say something to this effect, that the smoke of Satan has entered the Vatican, apparently said by Paul VI. Can you give us a little bit of your knowledge regarding the smoke of Satan and what some of the things that allegedly happened back in the early 60s?
Right, and it was really and that was Pope Paul VI, and he was talking, he said the church in general, you know. And the thing is about that, Zach, the difficult thing is it's a little more complex than that. He was, in his talk, that he was mentioning that, and to give it full context, he was mentioning how science and basically intellectualism were entering the church, and how scientism, you know, which has become a religion now. This making science into an idol was a real problem. So that's what he was alluding to. But you can really take a more generic view of it for certain, because right around the time that Polasek said that, you had the smoke entering the church, and it entered largely through loopholes that were created in Vatican II. Vatican II wasn't meant to be to have a liberal outcome, but boy, did it in so many ways, and in so many ways, it turned Catholic churches into Protestant ones. And so, I think we're going to end up turning that ship around. But it's, you know, it's like the Queen Elizabeth; it takes a while to turn her around. And frankly, whether you're talking the Latin Rite in a Catholic church or you're talking the Orthodox Church that you're a part of, having that mystery and that old style mysticism inserted into the liturgy is important. We are the mystical body of Christ, not the intellectual body of Christ. He didn't traverse the countryside with a blackboard uttering polysyllabic words, you know. So let's get back to simply acting like Jesus.
Yeah, we got to get the law from our brains, from our heads, from the skull, and put it in the heart where it belongs. We, in the West, we kind of reason. We use our intellect to reason, and we think that we can reason these things out when it comes to faith or just about any topic you can think of. We try to reason it out, and we think that our intellect is superior to God in many ways. We don't realize that we're doing it at the time, but that's how the devil confuses us and confounds us, where we try to figure it out on our own. Anytime, Michael, you get into a problem, I don't know about you, but it's taken me a long time to pray to God for the answer instead of trying to do what guys do. We are hunters. Well, problem, let's solve it. Where the women just want to talk about it. They don't want you to solve it. Or this is what I've been told over the years. Anyway, I can see the veritas and all of that. Let's move back to St. Michael. Who is St. Michael in relation to the other angels?
Well, you know, I can't say for sure, and no one can, except that we know from Scripture that he's got to be more powerful than Satan, because he cast Satan out of heaven. From what you can glean in Scripture, he's got to be as powerful or more powerful than any other angel to have done that, because we know Lucifer was really high up in the hierarchy, even took a third of the angels with him. And for Michael to have cast him down shows just tremendous power. He mentioned in a couple books of the Bible, or several, including even the book of Jude. And when other angels that may be high-ranking principalities and so forth have trouble, such as with the Prince of Persia, they have to go back and get Michael to assist them. So powerful, powerful, powerful. And he comes when we call. But like anything else, you know, we have to exercise that free will. And life on Earth is a test to see if we will invoke the tools that we need to fight the evil that is rising all around us. We have a headline story in Spirit Daily today about this affluent couple in Manhattan. Daily communicants go to church every day and so forth, but the wife is possessed. She's going to an exorcist. A voice speaks through her through the course of a day that is not her voice. And it comes from, because there's masonry, Freemasonry, in her lineage, her grandfather, I guess it was. So, and they point out in this article how once you see spiritual warfare, then you can't go back, and you can't help but to see it all around you. So we're in a battle, and the Archangel Michael has that sword that he'll take out and use to assist us.
Now, a lot of Protestants who might listen will wonder why Catholics and Orthodox, and I guess some Episcopals, and there, believe it or not, some Lutherans, will pray to the saints. And this word pray really means pleading for intercession, sort of like if you read some legal documents, I pray to the court will intercede, that will get involved. So what would you say to a Protestant listening, why Orthodox and Catholics pray to the saints?
Well, I would say that really a better term is that we ask the saints to pray for us and to use their power to assist us. I can ask you. I can say, Zach, will you pray for me? I have.
Yes, exactly.
You've done the same with me. Why can't I go to a high force like the Archangel Michael, the Blessed Mother, St. Joseph, and ask for their assistance like I do anyone on earth? And then there's that argument that that saints are idolatry. We're not supposed to make any images of anything on that's in heaven. But, you know, what about the Ark of the Covenant? There were images of angels that God instructed them to put on it. So I think that, a lot of times people just try to find things to hold so that they can justify, the way that they're worshiping. Well, I don't care, you know.
When you think about it, that's the devil trying to confuse you some more so that you don't tap into those resources that we've been given by our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ.
Oh, it's and you know, this time of year you really remember that, especially in a month when we're dealing with all souls and we're dealing with purgatorial souls and the fact that Protestants don't pray for their deceased, a lot of them. And mainstream ones, evangelicals, Pentecostals, and so forth. And that's a disaster. And therefore, all of us, every day I do, pray for all of the souls in purgatory because they can use assistance. But yeah, there's a lot of tools out there that aren't used because the devil has sowed dissension and confusion, like you said.
And let me encourage everyone that you can pray for a lost loved one or a friend. You can have conversations with your lost loved ones, like I do with my mom. One time, Michael, this is actually something that happened to me. My daughter was about 4 or 5 years old, and she has some issues, and she really couldn't tell us what was going on. And she had a fever, and instead of making it into the bathroom, she went on the floor before she got into the bathroom. So my wife is like, why does she do that? And I heard my mom's voice, very distinctive voice. She's got pneumonia. Take her to the doctor. And I woke up.
Yeah.
And I took her to the doctor, and I told my wife, and sure enough, she had pneumonia. So God will use saints and our loved ones and angels to deliver the message. And I can't figure out why sometimes we just ignore those messages, or God's trying to tell us to do something. No, God's not trying to tell us to do anything. He's telling us what to do. We're trying to, you know, discover God's will for us. And it's a process. Some people, like Paul, you can go from Saul to Paul, you know, with a snap of your fingers. Other people, the conversion takes a lot longer over time. You have what I consider justification and your sanctification, which leads to glorification, which are theological terms, which we don't have the time to even get into all of those things, but they're biblically based as well as traditional. And, you know, one of the dangers, Michael, I find, and we'll talk about Halloween in a second because we want to bring that up. One of the dangers I find is saved on Saturday, preaching from the pulpit on Sunday. Oh, that is a disaster. I'm not saying it can't happen, but I think we all got to hold ourselves a little bit and cool out and become patient. Because remember, Paul, it's 3 years before he does his first, he does his first sermon, right? Before he's out there speaking about Jesus Christ and how he was saved and all of those gospel stories that he's conveying to the early Christians. So it does take time, and it takes practice, and it's discipline. Your prayer life is all about discipline. Now, let's focus a little bit on Halloween, where people, some people, they go, I think, like, too far in either direction. It's like, no such thing. We're not going to do any Halloween. Nobody's going to have any fun. Nobody's going to dress any costumes. Well, you know, it's cute when your kid dresses up as a bumblebee or as a butterfly and they use their imagination. You know what you could also do? Dress up as your favorite saint. How about that? We have all kinds of icons in the Orthodox Church. You can be anybody you want. You can dress up as Moses, Isaiah, Elijah. You can dress up as Joseph, the mother, the father, the stepfather of Jesus. He could dress up as Mother Mary or Saint Elizabeth, Anna or Joachim. The characters in the Bible that you can dress up as are endless, and I think the saints would be honored by you trying to be like them, especially if you're a little child. You know, I want to be like Saint Michael. That's cool. So we can come up with better costumes as we celebrate Halloween. But then there's the nefarious part of Halloween that I would like you to talk about. And you've said before in past broadcasts here on SpiritDaily.com that there's certain things we want to avoid. So your advice as we approach Halloween.
Well, you know, first of all, I agree with you totally. I mean, Halloween is All Saints Eve. So why not take a look at costumes in that vein? When we have a representation of heaven, a statue, for instance, an icon, whatever it may be, it draws grace. It draws a certain presence, sometimes more than other times. You know, when it's blessed and when it's properly placed and so forth. The same thing happens on the dark side. When we have a representation of something that is nefarious, that is evil, that is dark, then a darkness is present to whatever degree. And, you know, it may look cute to see a little kid dressed up as the devil or Dracula or a girl as a witch, but there are spiritual connotations to these things. And you know, people can scoff at it just like they scoff at concern over Harry Potter, even though Harry Potter has actual witchcraft spells in the books that kids can then recite. And even though Harry Potter has led to a surge in witchcraft among our young people, they'll still say, oh, it's just books, they're great books. Recently, a Catholic priest went and got rid of the Potter books in the school library at his church, and parents raised a big stink over it. What are you doing? That's crazy, you know, and so forth. That's how blinded we are in our time, that even a Catholic library would allow in something like that. And so many good people, good Catholics, good Orthodox, good Protestants, allow their kids to dress up as evil figures on Halloween. It's not good. It doesn't redound to anyone's spiritual benefit.
Yeah, and it also, as people get older, they somehow take the whole idea of Halloween and make it into romantic things, where women will dress up as pirate women. I think there's probably a term for that. But and then, you know, I can remember those events. You know, not exactly wholesome. Same thing with other holidays that we celebrate, like Valentine's Day, February 14th. Oh boy. When did all of this, or Christmas, it becomes give her the diamond ring, you know, something special in the stocking, the new car, and love is in the air with all of our holidays, it seems. It's been hijacked by that. Am I wrong about that?
No, you're right, and I want to go back to your point about wearing saint costumes for Halloween. Let's take Halloween back from the devil. Just like Christmas was instituted by the Christian Church to take that time of year back from the pagans, because look at everything from mistletoe to the Christmas tree and so forth. Those have origins in paganism, mm-hmm. but we have made them into Christian symbols for a Christian day, and we should do the same thing with Halloween, which is when our time, Zach. Halloween, as I'm sure you noticed in Manhattan, because last year at this time I was in Manhattan, and it's turning into another Christmas. There were so many decorations around the city, so many bizarre zombies in front of storefronts and so forth, skulls. You know, these things, they bring a spirituality as well as a psychological mood, and that's where it's the devil's Christmas is Halloween, and it grows every year, so it's a cause of concern.
Yeah, I pretty much walk around with blinders on. Once you've been in New York long enough, you start to put up blinders. You don't even notice half the stuff that other people notice when they come to town. For instance, what goes on in Times Square, which is an amazing place. And I have to say this, with everything that goes on in Times Square, I kind of really dig the bravery of some of the people that preach the gospel in the streets. Boy, they get some nasty looks going in their direction. I'm thinking, wow, That is pretty bold to be doing that, you know. So
It is. God bless them. And I know, you know, to be frank about it, Zach, I left New York. Well, there were a number of reasons. I lived in Manhattan for 9 years on the Upper East Side. And I left mainly because I was becoming more and more active in my Christianity, and I couldn't take the quote electricity unquote in New York. What is the electricity of New York anyway? What is it defined as? I mean, I just didn't like the spirit, and that's because you can't get much more worldly than Manhattan.
No. Well, and for me, you know, I would love to be able to one day move somewhere else, but God has me here for a reason, and I serve St. Sergius of Radonezh on 93rd and Park, which if you're listening and you ever want to discover Orthodoxy, feel free to come over on the Sunday morning. We do the English service, so you don't have to worry about learning any different languages, although sometimes, every once in a while, we'll slip in a little Russian. We can't help it. But it is the, I guess, the English mission. At the cathedral, and it's a beautiful church, one of the most beautiful churches you'll ever find. The other beautiful church I have to brag about is the church my mom grew up in. It's St. Peter's and Paul's Russian Orthodox Church in Passaic, New Jersey. It is a, you might say, not only a church, but a living museum, and the icons are amazing. And this church was funded by the Tsar Nicholas before he abdicated and before he was murdered. He's now regarded as a martyred saint in the Russian Orthodox Church. He gave $100,000. It's the most palatial, beautiful church you've ever seen. It is true Terre Haute, heaven on earth, amazingly beautiful.
Go ahead.
I was just going to say it's something to be seen. Go ahead. What were you going
to
say?
I'd like to see it someday. And I'd like to also promote the church that where I came back to be an active Christian, and that's Our Lady Good Counsel on 90th Street between 3rd and 2nd Avenue.
Oh, wow. Not too far from mine.
No, and beautiful, more than 100 years old, all granite on the outside. The inside is incredible. But I'll tell you, I think they were renovating the last time I was in New York. But, you know, I had an experience around this time of year that brought me back to the church, a series of dreams when I was living at 200 East 90th Street on the corner there of 3rd and the 12th floor of a high rise, and it involved the Archangel Michael, and it's an account I have written about. It's an account that people always are asking me to tell them about. It was a series of three dreams, and there were these there were several angels around me. I was like on a gurney with my feet facing the door of apartment 12A there in 200 East 90th Street. And it was like they were healing me, and I couldn't look directly at them. But I finally, to make a long story short, sometime if you want, I'll tell you the whole story. But when I was trying to look at the one who seemed to be in charge, they were speaking like a language I had no clue about. It sounded ancient to me. And when I tried to turn to the one who seemed to be leading the others, I got the feeling that they were angels and they could have made themselves, they were energy. They could have looked any way they wanted to. They were spirit. And the one who was to my left seemed to be in charge. I said, "Who are you?" And he said, "I'm the Archangel Michael. Now look." And he pointed to the door of my apartment, and this face that was clearly demonic, if not Satan himself, appeared like this living etching. And I'll tell you, Zach, at the time I was writing a book about the mafia in New Jersey, and you know, I was dealing with a lot of heavy hitters, but they were nothing. A hitman's nothing compared to what I saw. What I saw in that dream was something very real in a different way and far more frightening than anything in the mafia. And that dream was a three-parter. When I woke up, went to sleep, it continued right where it left off three times. So that brought me back, and it brought me to Our Lady Good Counsel on 90th Street.
Well, explain the message that you were given by the angels a little bit, if you can.
Well, you know, basically it was unsaid. It was just they were pointing out at the end of the... I was too afraid. The one who said his name was Michael was saying, when a face appeared, said, say... vanish. And I was too afraid to. I woke up at first. And then when I went back to sleep, you know, and the face appeared again, I woke up in stark terror because I'm thinking, well, what is this? This isn't like a normal dream. And no one to call. My best friends at the time were working at the New York Times, you know, where they're not going to believe me. And I went back to sleep, and a third time it continued. Finally, I got the courage to say vanish when that terrible face appeared on a door, and the face disappeared. And instead, there was a ring of keys there, an address on West 21st Street in Chelsea, where I had been, besides all this stuff with the mafia, which is enough to give you some spiritual baggage, grit, dirt, whatever you want to call it. I had a cottage interest in ghosts and so forth, and it was supposedly a haunted house down there that I had been kind of looking into. And that address was now on my door as if I was being told, the devil is literally at your door. So that helped shove me back to the church after many years of not practicing Catholicism.
That is a real amazing story. We're running out of time right now. Next week, you're going to take a break. You'll be at the annual Catholic Conference, October 4th to the 6th in Alexandria, Virginia. What's going on there?
Oh, that's not me.
Oh,
no,
I just saw this. I thought you said you were going to be somewhere next week.
No, I will be in... I will be starting a week from Saturday. I'll be in Medjugorje.
Oh, Medjugorje. So yeah. We'll be having another show next week then.
Yes, we can.
Oh, okay.
We can do that.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so on next week's show, let's talk more about these angels, Michael and Gabriel, and Raphael is another of the archangels that gets mentioned. And we'll also discuss the difference between the cherubim and the seraphim. You think you can handle all that? Because that's really exciting stuff.
I think purgatorial souls are important also.
Okay, so we'll discuss all of those things next time on SpiritDaily.com. Go to SpiritDaily.com to get the latest book from Michael H. Brown, Lying Wonders, Strangest Things. It's a great read. It's one of those books, if you're going to New York to L.A., by the time you take off and by the time you land, you should be pretty much finished with it. It's a nice read, right?
Well, I hope so. I hope it seems to move quickly because it's 62 accounts of various incredible things around the world, and each chapter is just a two, three, four, five pages of hopefully really swift moving dialogue and narrative.
Thank you very much for spending time with us. It's always
a
pleasure, Michael.
Thank you.
Go to SpiritDaily.com to get the latest books and videos from Michael H. Brown.